Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the GMP Plus webinar. We will wait another 5 minutes to start the webinar, so sit back and relax, and we will come back to you in a couple of minutes. Hello, everybody. Welcome to the GMP Plus webinar. We will wait another 2 minutes and then we will start with the presentation. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the GMP Plus webinar about purchase of foodstuff and former foodstuff. We will start the presentation, so ears and eyes open. If you've got a question during the presentation, you can ask this by clicking on the arrow to open the GoToWebinar tooling and there is a question box. You can open that, and that's where you can enter your question. During the presentation, we will see which of the questions we can already answer by just writing you the answer, and some questions will be answered after the presentation. And if we don't have enough time to answer your question during this webinar, we will come back to you after. The presentation will take at around 20 to 25 minutes. And as said, after that, we will discuss some of the questions. This webinar will be recorded, so it will be shared with you later on. The speakers of this webinar. My name is Ida Verwij, and I'm working for GMP Plus International for already 4 years. And most of the work I'm doing is customer focused. And I'm thinking along with a lot of the projects within GMP Plus. And I'm also working as an information management employer. And this webinar is held together with my colleague Dalia. She's working for GMP Plus for 16 years already, so she knows everything about the content of the scheme. And she was part of the harmonization of purchase project with all the other feed safety schemes and the GMP Plus working groups. We hope this webinar is informative and it gives you a better understanding of the requirements for purchase of foodstuff and former foodstuff. So the agenda of today, first we will start with a presentation about the requirements for purchase of the specific food and foodstuffs and former foodstuffs. So we start with a short introduction, then we will show you what's changed in the purchase requirements in the new GMP Plus BA10 document. Then we'll dig some a little deeper into the purchase of foodstuff and former foodstuff. Then I will tell you something about the notification system of GMP Plus International. And after that, my colleague Dalia will address some practical issues that some companies faced and informed us about. And then it's time to discuss the questions. So, a short introduction. The food industry is a major supplier of ingredients for the feed, but also feed, of course, results in egg, meat, and milk. So both are highly connected. And of course, there are some products that can't be used in the food industry and are considered being waste. But there are different types of waste, of course. Some products are actually waste and can't be used other than just as waste. Some products are both not food and not feed, and they are used as biogas, compost, or fuel. There are also some products considered being byproducts, former foodstuffs, and foodstuffs. Byproducts are products that are coming from a food company as a regular product that's related to the production of food, but is not considered being a food product. And the companies producing these kind of products, such as potato peelings, for example, need to be GMP Plus certified for the activity of the production, but also they, of course, produce a food product. And the production of food and former foodstuffs and former foodstuffs is not something that can be brought under GMP Plus certification, and therefore the gatekeeping is required. This webinar is focused on the purchase of the foodstuff and the former foodstuff. So what's the difference between the foodstuff and a former foodstuff? Well, most importantly, both were intended originally for human consumption. So at the start of the production, the products were produced with the intention to be sold for human consumption. But for the former foodstuffs, during the process of the production, something went wrong and the products are no longer intended to be sold for human consumption. And these can be considered former foodstuffs. But what is very important is that the products classified as a former foodstuff do not present any health risks to be used in the feed. So let's test your knowledge. We've got some questions in the poll ready for you. So my colleague will open a question and you can answer it. And it's anonymous, so don't worry if you're not sure about the answer. And of course, I will share you the right answers after we close the question. So we can start with the first question. That's about the classification of a potato peeling. Is that considered being a byproduct, a foodstuff, a former foodstuff, or Something else? You can answer by clicking on the correct answer and then after that click on submit. I see still some answers coming in. I just wait a little bit more, a little bit longer. We are collecting the responses. Well, I think it's good to go to the second question. Potato peelings, can this be used in feed, yes or no? Or maybe you do not know. Again, you can answer by clicking on the correct answer and then after that click on submit. So now I will give you the answers to both of these questions. Potato peelings are a byproduct and they can be used in feed. Then we've got another question and that's about outdated cookies. Is that a foodstuff, a former foodstuff, a byproduct or something else? Click on the correct answer and click submit. And outdated cookies, can they be used in the feed? Yes or no? Outdated cookies are classified as a former foodstuff because, as already said, outdated, they are no longer intended for human consumption. So that's why it's a former foodstuff and they can be used in feed. I can imagine animals would like some cookies. Then we've got a next question. It's about molasses from the sugar factory. Is that a foodstuff, a former foodstuff, a byproduct, or something else? And then the next question would be, can molasses from the sugar factory be used in feed, yes or no? Molasses from the sugar factory are classified as a byproduct, and they can also be used in feed, so it's the same as the potato peelings. It's a regular product that comes from the production of sugar, but cannot be used for human consumption, but is a very good product to be used in feed. So what about the sugar itself? Is it a foodstuff, a former foodstuff, a byproduct, or something else? And this sugar, can it be used in feed? Yes or no? Sugar is a foodstuff and can be used in feed. And it's a foodstuff, but yeah, still, of course, companies can use it to sweetener their feed products without any problem. It's safe for humans, but it's also safe to be used for animal feed. Then we've got some other question. It's chocolate flakes with too much flavoring. Is that a foodstuff, a former foodstuff, a byproduct, or something else? And can this product be used in feed, yes or no? Can this product be used in feed, yes or no? Chocolate flakes with too much flavoring are a former foodstuff, but they can be used in feed. But of course, there needs to be a check on what's too much in the product and is it safe to be used or not. Then we've got another question, lightly burned sausage rolls. Is it a foodstuff, a former foodstuff, a byproduct, or something else? And could these products be used in feed? Well, this is maybe a little bit a tricky question because the lightly burned sausage rolls could be considered being a former foodstuff, but what is very important is that they can't be used in feed because sausages are, of course, meat and that's animal protein. And as most of you might know, there are some limitations on the use of animal proteins in feed. So it's maybe not a black and white answer, but we would say you cannot use it in feed. Then we've got one question left, that's leftovers from a restaurant. Is it a foodstuff, a former foodstuff, a byproduct, or something else? And then, could these products be used in feed, yes or no? And again, for the leftovers for restaurants, it's more or less the same as the lightly burned sausage rolls. They cannot be used in the feed, but also leftovers from a restaurant are considered being something else than a foodstuff or former foodstuff. It's not something used in the feed or the food. And also this got to do with the very strict restrictions on the use of animal proteins. Thank you for participating in the poll. And again, if you've got any question, open the webinar tooling by clicking on the arrow in the red button, and you can ask your questions in the questions box. And then we continue with the presentation. Shortly, there's an overview of the answers to the poll. As we will share this presentation and the webinar, you can still have an insight in the correct answers. So we want to explain something about the changes to the old and the new GMP Plus purchase requirements. A GMP Plus company can purchase feed products from GMP Plus certified companies or companies certified for equivalent schemes. But not all products that a feed company is purchasing can be purchased from certified sources. And with certified, I mean certification for feed safety. And this is also the case for foodstuff and former foodstuff. These products can be purchased via the application of a gatekeeper protocol. And those requirements are laid down in the GMP Plus BA10 document. And the last couple of years, GMP Plus International worked intensively with other feed schemes to harmonize the purchase requirements and the gatekeeper protocols. But also the gatekeeper protocols were evaluated with the GMP Plus working groups. And as a result of all of this, the gatekeeper protocols were drawn up as new protocols, and there were some changes. So what is very important is that in the old version of the GMP Plus BA10 document, so the purchase requirements, there was one risk profile for foodstuff and former foodstuff. And also both were in one common protocol described. But now there are two risk profiles and also two separate gatekeeper protocols for foodstuff and former foodstuff with both their own requirements. The old GMP Plus BA10 document can still be applied up until the end of 2020. And the new version can already be applied since the publication in March this year. It's up to the companies to decide which of the two protocols they are using, but we would advise you to already use the new BA10 document because it's got some more options for purchasing products, not only foodstuff and former foodstuff, but also some of the other gatekeeper protocols are changed in your own benefit. There are some changes regarding to the witness and the supplier audit, but that will be addressed later on in this presentation. And also the requirement for the application of a exemption. There are some changes in that also, and it's got to do with the notification system of GMP Plus, but also that will be addressed later in this presentation. The same goes for the restriction that was in the past in the protocol for the purchase of foodstuff and former foodstuff about the company that produces these food products was already certified for the production of their byproducts. And there was a restriction on purchasing from these kind of companies. You could not use the gatekeeper protocol, but this also has changed. But that will be addressed by my colleague Dalia later on in the presentation. So we now will dig deeper in some of the gatekeeper protocols. We will start with the purchase of the foodstuff. Foodstuffs are considered being a low-risk product compared to former foodstuff. But there's still a need to use a gatekeeper protocol, so a company, a feed company purchasing foodstuff needs to pay attention because, of course, there's a difference in legislation between food and feed. And also the application of the product for human versus animals, there are some differences. So that's why that's also the focus of the purchasing company, that they have to pay attention to these considerations. So what's needed is that the company producing the foodstuff is certified for a scheme that's recognized by GFSI or by any of the codes. Guides of good practice. If you would open this presentation yourself, you can click on the link and you go to the website of the GFSI, but I will give you an example that, for example, BRC and IFS are schemes that are recognized by GFSI. But the gatekeeper is responsible for some things. That's, for example, the monitoring. They need to monitor the product, but how they do it is risk-based because they have all the information about the product and they can risk-based analyze what needs to be monitored on. It's their responsibility, and also it's their responsibility to check if there is a need for a supplier audit. This is also something risk-based. And there's no requirement to include the product that the company is purchasing into the FSP product list. This is a difference compared to other gatekeeper protocols where the companies purchase a feed material. But for the purchase of foodstuff, there's no requirement that the product will be included in the FSP product list. And there is some change compared to the old version of the BA10, so the old purchase requirements, and that's the feed safety data sheet, it's no longer required that the company needs to fill in this data sheet. So this all counts for the purchase of a foodstuff. But of course, there are some different requirements now for the purchase of former foodstuff, because as I already mentioned, they are now divided in two separate gatekeeper protocols. So we now have a look at that. So the purchase of a former foodstuff. Also here, there are some considerations why there is a need for the gatekeeper protocols to be followed. And that's most importantly that not all risks are covered by the food safety system of a company. A food company producing food is focused on the products that they're selling for human consumption. And that's why it's very important as a gatekeeper, so as a feed company purchasing a former foodstuff, that it's very, very clear if all the risks are covered by either the company producing the product or you acting as a gatekeeper. And also, because of that, it's very important to know the reason why a product is classified as a former foodstuff. So to say, what's wrong with the product? Why is it no longer a foodstuff? So to make sure that all of that is covered and safe and assured, at least the food company needs to have a HACCP plan. So that's a difference compared to the purchase of a foodstuff. It sounds less strict, but it's got to do with the fact that the gatekeeper is way more responsible for the purchase of former foodstuff, of course. So the gatekeeper, besides checking if the company producing the former foodstuff has got a HACCP plan, they need to monitor the product. This is also risk-based because they know the product and they know how to monitor. There is a requirement on a yearly supplier audit. So that's the difference compared to the purchase of foodstuff. And there needs to be an agreement between the seller and the buyer. And this got mostly to do also again with the responsibilities on covering all the risks. On behalf or by GMP Plus International, there will be a check on the quality of the supplier audit. This is something similar to the witness audit, and this will be addressed and explained by my colleague Dalia later on in this presentation. So that's also a very strict requirement. And the feed safety data sheet needs to be filled in. So there's again a difference between the purchase of a foodstuff and a former foodstuff, because this is not required for the purchase of foodstuff. And also the product being purchased needs to be included in the FSP product list. This is already done the last couple of years, so most former foodstuffs are either as a product or as a group of product already included in the FSP product list. But whenever you want to purchase a former foodstuff that's not yet in the FSP product list, of course there needs to be a request to include this product. The protocols for former foodstuff and foodstuff can be applied anywhere and anytime. So there's no restriction on origin, for example, but for the purchase of former foodstuff, there is a restriction on resale. So it means if you are a trader and you're purchasing a former foodstuff, you can only sell it to a company that's actually processing the product into the feed chain. So it's sure that all the information that you receive as a gatekeeper is still very clear, and it's a very short chain in that way. So you can apply it anywhere at any time, but it's most importantly, there is a restriction on the resell possibilities. So that's it for the gatekeeper protocol so far. I will now tell you something about the notification system. In the past, as explained before, based on the old version of the BA10 document, companies who wishes to purchase a former foodstuff had to request an exemption. And this is no longer needed for the new BA10 document, but from now on, it's required to inform GMP Plus International about the use of any of the gatekeeper protocols. It doesn't matter which of the ones you're using, so also for foodstuff, former foodstuff, any of them, and you have to fill in a form on the GMP Plus website. By that, you notify GMP Plus. And this information is used for the evaluation of the gatekeeper protocols together with all the other feed scheme that we work with. And the information is considered and treated confidential, and we anonymize all the information before we share it with the other schemes, of course. I will briefly show you what it looks like. So if you're on the GMP Plus website, here you can see how to navigate to this specific web page. And you can see that for all of the gatekeeper protocols, we've got a separate form. And this one includes the purchase of the foodstuff. And this one is for the former foodstuff. I will quickly show you one of them. So what is asked is some company information, how many products you would like to purchase. And based on the number that you choose, you would see how that you have to fill in some product information and some information from the producer. And also for the former foodstuff, by filling in the form, you also agree that GMP Plus International can send a by them designated auditor to join the supplier audit. And again, this is something that will be explained by my colleague Dalia. So for now, thank you for listening to this part of the presentation. And my colleague Dalia will now address some of the practical issues.
Yes, thank you very much, Ida. Ida has just explained the purchasing requirements for foodstuff and former foodstuff. And I would like to go a little bit more into depth about some practical issues that we have collected. The first issue would be about about something that Ida has mentioned in her presentation. And it is about GFSI recognition and about this code of practice. What are these things and why they are important for you as the gatekeeper? Well, to answer this question, you have first to realize that there are many different food safety certification schemes all over the world. But not all of them guarantee the same level of food safety. If a scheme has GFSI recognition, or if foodstuff is produced under an approved code of practice, then this guarantees a high level of food safety assurance. And therefore, we say when you buy foodstuff which are produced or under GFSI recognition or under an approved code of practice, then you can use the gatekeeper protocol for foodstuff, which is a less stricter protocol. But if you purchase foodstuff which is produced under a scheme which is not GFSI recognized, or the foodstuff which is not produced under an approved code of practice, then we consider these to be a little bit more risky products, and therefore you have to use a gatekeeper for former foodstuff, which is a little bit more stricter. The next issue would be about purchase of fruit, unprocessed fruits and vegetables. I think when you yes, the presentation is a little bit slow. When you consider purchasing foodstuff and former foodstuff, then what pops up in your mind is perhaps old bread or broken cookies or sugar, oil, but not directly vegetables and fruits. While this is rather a big flow from food to feed, think of all these unsold fruits and vegetables from auctions or from the supermarkets, or fruits and vegetables which simple does not look nice enough to be sold, or fruit and vegetables that cannot be processed to food because there is already too much of it on the food market. Actually, the last example is something that is happening right now. All these potatoes that cannot be processed to the French fries because the restaurants are closed, all these potatoes will be sold to feed. So if you look at these products, you realized that originally they were all grown to be sold for human consumption, but somewhere in the process something went wrong due to quality reasons or due to economical reasons. They will not be sold to food, but to feed. So they perfectly fit in the definition of former foodstuffs. And to purchase these fruit and vegetables, you can use the gatekeeper for former foodstuff. Then we go to the next issue, and it will be about the status of food additives, how to purchase food additives, what does it mean for you? Food additives are a little bit special products, because for food there are additives, but for feed it depends on the feed legislation. The big part of food additives are also feed additives, so you can purchase them under the gatekeeper protocol for feed additives. But some food additives are actually feed materials, and therefore to purchase them you can use the gatekeeper protocol for foodstuffs. But the good news is it doesn't matter if there are feed additives or feed materials, we have now one same protocol to purchase these food additives. You can, because we have one protocol, the same protocol for additives, for foodstuffs, for pharma products. So for the purchasing requirements, it really doesn't matter if food additives are feed additive or feed material. But on the other hand, you have to keep in mind when you apply these food additives that something can be different in labeling or in dosage or in other things, depending if they are feed additives of feed materials. So keep in mind what animal feed legislation says about these products. Then we will go to the next issue, which would be about something that Ida has already mentioned before, and it is about the former restriction that you were not able to apply gatekeeper protocol for foodstuff and former foodstuff at a company which is already GMP plus certified. In the picture that you have already seen before, you can see that there can be different flows from a food company to feed. If we take, for example, let's say sugar company. Sugar company produces sugar, which is foodstuff, but also molasses and sugar beet pulp, which is byproducts. For these byproducts, company is GMP certified. And in the old situation, there was the rule that if food company is already GMP certified for the byproducts, that also foodstuffs must be brought under this GMP certification. So you were not allowed to use gatekeeper protocol for this company. Well, luckily, there were some new insights, and we have realized that this is not logical, and this is also legally even not possible, because foodstuffs and byproducts are totally different type of products. Sugar is a foodstuff, and from the first to the last production step, it is meant to be sold for human consumption. But for example, sugar beet pulp, it was never mentioned to be sold for human consumption. Therefore, this rule is deleted, and from now on, you can purchase foodstuff and former foodstuff under gatekeeper from a company which is already GMP certified for the byproducts. So let's move to the next issue, and it would be about responsibilities that you have as a gatekeeper. Somewhere in BA10 it is mentioned that you can have agreement with your supplier about mutual responsibilities. So you can imagine that you perhaps can transfer some responsibilities to your supplier, to the food company. What does it really mean in practice? Does it mean that you can just lean back and say to your supplier, okay, I will buy your stuff, but then you have to arrange everything? Well, no, this is not possible because as gatekeeper, you have a big responsibility. You are purchasing non-certified product and you bring this product to the GMP chain. So you have some core responsibility, such is that you have to make a solid risk-based assessment and of the product that you buy. And also you have to do monitoring to be sure that the product is safe. So this kind of responsibilities you cannot transfer to your supplier. But for example, you can execution things you can agree with your supplier. For example, you can ask food company to do the sampling for you because for them it is easier. Also, when you fill the feed safety data sheet, you can ask the food company to help you with that because they have all information about production of that foodstuff, the former foodstuff. So the conclusion is, yes, you can transfer some responsibilities to the supplier, but there are some core responsibilities that you really have to do yourself because it is part of good gatekeeper. Okay, then the next issue will be about transport of foodstuffs from a food company to the gatekeeper. It is feasible to expect that when you purchase foodstuffs or former foodstuffs that they must be transported from food factory to your premises, and perhaps there is even a storage in between. All these steps between food company and between you, they can all be covered under the gatekeeper protocol, which means that you have to include them in your risk assessment of the supply chain. And so you don't have to have certified transport, or you don't have to use certified storage in between, but you have to take care that all feed safety risks are covered. Okay, then we have some more issues. It is, oh yes, this is the very much discussed issue in the past. In the old situation, as a gatekeeper, you had to undergo this witness audit at least once in a 3 year. Witness audit, it means that when you go to your supplier to carry out supplier audit, that somebody from your certification body, your auditor, would go with you and they would check how do you carry out the supplier audit. And there was a lot of discussion about this because it was not clear why is it necessary to be that strict. And again, during this discussion, we came to new insights. For example, that, okay, former foodstuffs are perhaps a little bit more critical product, but they are not more critical than any other product which is used in feed materials, so in feed. So why is it necessary to have such a strict witness audit requirements for this gatekeeper protocol? And also, even more important, we really recognize that a gatekeeper is perfectly capable to perform a sound and solid supplier audit. So it is really not necessary that we, as you know, as a kind of mother-in-law, go with you and check what you are doing there. So this requirement is changed. And it is now that, first of all, this witness audit will not be performed by a certification body, but it will be performed by GMP Plus or on behalf of GMP Plus. So you do not have to make any special arrangements for it. And also, it will not be at least one obliged witness audit per 3 years. No, it will be now risk-based, so you can perhaps undergo this witness audit, but GMP Plus International will decide it if it is necessary based on the realistic elements or realistic risks. So I think, if I remember that this was correctly, this was the last item of that we would like to discuss a little bit deeper. And now we would like to ask you if you have some more questions. Please use for this the question box.
Thank you, Dalia, for addressing these topics. And indeed, as my colleague explained, you can ask your questions. You can do this by opening the GoToWebinar tooling. If correct, you would see a button with a red button with a white arrow in it. If you click on that, there are some functionalities opened, and there should be an option to open a question box, and you can ask your questions in there. And then we can see which of those we can address during this presentation. And thank you again for listening. Instead of typing in your question, you can also raise your hand, of course, digitally, and then we can see if we can unmute you, and then you can ask your question. I see we've got a question. And the question is on feed additives. And is there a possibility to deliver outdated products to feed? Dalia, could you give an answer to this question, please?
Yes, thank you very much. Food additives, they're coming from the food company, so it is you can you have to check, of course, their status in feed. So if food additives are also feed additives, you can purchase them as a feed additive, but you have to check what is the consequence from then to being outdated. Is it still possible to use this as feed? Because perhaps if the product is outdated for food, and the same rules are also for feed, then it can lose its functionality, and then you cannot use it in feed. So you always have to check this according to the feed legislation.
Okay, thank you, Dalia, for answering. If this won't give an answer to your question, please let us know, and we will also send you the answers to the questions by writing after this webinar. And I also see another question, and let me see. Can former ingredients intended for food production also be covered by the former foodstuff protocol? And also, Dalia, could you answer this question, please? So can former ingredients intended for the production of food be covered by the former foodstuff protocol?
Well, it would be great to make a little bit more precise what is example of such a food ingredient. Would it be possible to give it to us, Mr. Auerhand? I don't see anything yet. Would it be possible to type it, or?
I can also see if I can unmute.
Yes, please.
But
perhaps
I do not know if
easier.
That's if that's okay. But that is an option. But also, we could also address this question in writing later on. That's also fine. But for now, we need a little bit more information in order to answer the question. Let me see.
I don't. Oh yes, I see it. I don't have a concrete example yet. Well, I think you can imagine that some former ingredients, just think which kind of product, there must be products which are actually not foodstuff yet. I don't know, perhaps some we have, what I could imagine is, for example, some flavoring, some yeast extracts which are used for flavoring of that kind of stuff. You can add it to the sauce or to the soup. And yes, there are actually also products which are originally intended to be used for food. So I don't see, to be honest, the problem to use them to purchase them under protocol of former foodstuff. But nevertheless, just like to have some more example, because I think it is also interesting for another companies to give some guidance in this.
Yes, we will see if we can get in contact after the webinar maybe, and then whenever we send you the presentation and the webinar, we can also maybe include the questions and answers that were asked now, or maybe also for people that want to like to ask their questions later on, so not during the webinar, but please feel free to send your questions via the email after this webinar. That's also fine, and we can see which of them we can all include in communication afterwards.
Yeah, because it's they're very good questions. Also this one, I mean, the food company will buy these ingredients with purpose to produce food. So it is logical, this is part of food production, but just to be sure, it would be nice to have some concrete examples. Yes.
So I think we've handled all the questions that we received so far. Again, whenever you still have a question after this webinar, feel free to send it to us. You can send it to a webinar at gnpplus.org. But also anytime, you can always, of course, ask your questions by sending an email to info@gnpplus.org or by filling in our contact form on the website. We are